Let's get some more people. I would be a shit teacher, definitely. I know I'm not good for that kind of work at all. In any sense. Drugs. It's having withdrawal effects. The biggest problem, at least in your education system, is that at no point does anyone focus on simple things like how to learn, because, yeah, that is a definitely big problem I possess here as well. They just teach you stuff and expect you to learn, but they never actually teach you how to learn or anything like that. Our university especially has been bad with that. Although it's getting better. Like, for example, the master's thesis and the bachelor's thesis, they just expect you to be able to write suddenly like a 30-page work on some subject, and then master's degree like something like 80 to 100 pages, and they never actually teach you how to do that. They just expect that you know how to do it. Of course, there's like a couple courses that teach you like essay writing and stuff like that, but nothing on that grand scale or that big scale. And you need to actually, when you do like a master's thesis of that size, you actually need to do like a research. And how to do that research, especially in your field, is never taught in any way. And that's a big problem. Luckily, at least on our archaeology department, they have noticed that, and it's getting better now. Like, they are redoing the whole way how archaeology is going. Like how they are teaching archaeology in our university now, and it's focusing a lot on the actual research. Like most of the classes and courses are gonna be somehow tied to the current research that's being done at the department, and everything pretty much is part of that process. So you get to do during those courses like the actual research that goes into the archaeology. Instead of just a theory and basically information, and I think that's really good. You get like a hands-on approach much more on that, which is definitely needed for archaeology. Even though it's one of the humanities studies, I think it requires much more hands-on approach than the other humanities studies. The thing about teaching is that every student is like a snowflake, a bit unique, and there's no production line method that will just take students without a grade. Yeah, that is very, very true, Ned. Sadly, they are trying to get that production line method that they just push out degrees, and they don't actually see the needs of a individual student. At least that's how the Finnish universities have been in recent years. I'm really looking forward to this archaeology change though, but it's not gonna help me in any way, because I'm done already. So it's not gonna help me, but hopefully the next generation archaeologists will be actually much better and put me out of job because they are more qualified. What did Dalsalur say? You did teacher training in 07 to be teacher of English. You quit. During that period, when I was doing teacher training, there were courses in didactics. Finish day? Yeah, that's impossible for you, Dalsador. You're like me. One of those creatures of the night. Snowflakes directly from... nice, Giuliani. That was one of the reasons why I quit also the technical department. I was doing electric engineering for 3 years at the university, well, studying that. And one of the reasons I quit there as well was because, well, I didn't like it, was the main reason, I guess. But also that the teaching was just absolute garbage. It was definitely that production line mentality with way too many students and massive mass lectures on everything, and they expected you to be basically do everything without actually teaching you how to do anything, and it just didn't feel like for me. I had a lot of fun doing like all the programming courses and stuff like that, but the other stuff just killed it for me. I wanted to change. When I changed to the archaeology department, I was really happy because it was much smaller groups, like 10 to 15 students or even less sometimes. So it's much easier to get more personal teaching and all that. And also, like Dalsador says, they also had a really bad teachers at the technical department. Yeah, that night was blah blah for 2 hours. All of your 400 students absorb into your neurons for my monotone bored voice. Yeah, exactly. It was definitely like that. And teachers also felt that, like, they gave no shit about what they were doing. They were, like, totally given up on life. Was, like, the feeling you got from them when they were teaching you. There was, like, zero passion in what they were doing. Which probably is true, at least for some of them, because, a lot of, I keep using the archaeology as an example, but it's a good example. Most of the people who teach archaeology in our department are actually doctor's students or people who would like to actually just do research in archaeology and not do teaching. But the position they have at the university requires them to teach a certain amount of courses every year. So it's pretty much something that's just forced on them, and they wouldn't want to do it. So they do just the absolute minimum effort to do it, although it's getting better now. and they actually likes to teach and actually interact with the students, which is definitely a bonus. Course at 400 participants, basically everyone doing teacher training. 4 exam books, all of... That's nice, nice dollar. So you're pretty much expecting to buy the book yourself. We had a couple of old courses like that as well. But in those courses you were expected to read archaeology books in like Norwegian or like Germany or whatever. Any of the like non main languages that you're using yourself. Not Swedish, not even Swedish, like Norwegian or Germany. I mean, if it's in Finnish, English or Swedish, it would be doable by most of the people. But these were like in languages that you, unless you study them specifically, you have like no idea what is it about. And that was one of the required courses for everyone. And everyone definitely didn't do those languages. And it was utter bullshit. Thank God that's not a thing anymore. Yeah, that was one of the like old school teachers that just forced it on people. That's really dumb. Thank God he got retired. Let's do a carpentry thing here as well. No equipment. What do you mean no equipment? Oh wait, it's not built yet. You remember the Universal books where action photocopies of photocopies of more photocopies? Yeah, we have a kind of that as well. Especially on the like a technical department, we have this print service bill like a thingy, and they print out like a course material that you can need to go buy yourself, and it's like a photocopies of photocopies of photocopies and stuff put together by the teachers, and you need to go buy them yourself. Archaeology, on the other hand, doesn't do anything like that, which is nice. You don't really need to buy any book for archaeology. There are some really illogical approaches to teaching. Yeah, there is. There is also. We got a new professor at our archaeology department last year, who is quite young and from Helsinki. Well, he also studied in Oulu, but he was working as a head of the faculty in Helsinki, a temporary one. And when our previous professor got retired, fired at the same time, he took the place, and he's been changing a lot of those like old bullshit illogical approaches for teaching and bringing them from the like the 60s approach back to 2000, and it's been amazing. It's been so good. I don't know exactly. Dulcidor probably knows better than me, actually. Nice. I know it's okay, but not the best. Yeah, those are fun, nice as well. Just give me a paper I can copy if I need this. We had a lot of courses where like the teacher is showing a PowerPoint presentation and explaining shit with that. And instead of forcing everyone to write down the whole bullshit, what is in the PowerPoints and all that, they just give out you the either the PowerPoints before the actual lesson or just printed out at the lesson, so you get the PowerPoints and all the text handed to you, and you can just focus on what's being discussed about the thing and not just spend the whole lecture writing down shit. I actually figured out quite early on at school that writing down didn't help me that much, because I never went back and looked at my what I wrote down. It probably would have helped if I actually read what I was writing down. I figured out that if I don't spend time on writing and focus on that and spend all my focus on what the teacher is actually saying and doing, I was doing much, much better. So I stopped doing it totally, and I just spent all my focus on the teacher and what was being said and all that, and I was doing much better that way. Yeah, that sounds about right. Dalsidor. I think that's bugging. Yeah, it was. It didn't show the carpentry thing, because I started this before those were built. You stopped too? Yeah. You can't organize probably at the speed they want me to write at. Yeah. Same here, Knight. Also, writing quickly and lot of stuff makes my hands hurt, so it was also an added bonus. If I would go to school again, I would take audio notes and photos. I actually saw someone do that, Ashtamner. Like, they had a recording device, and they just recorded what was being said. Yeah, well, my wife was yelling there that like the modern phones and stuff, mobile devices would actually be actually really good for that. Rural areas have more openings for a few challenges than cities. Yeah, definitely. Because no one wants to live in the middle of nowhere and be a teacher. It's not just teachers, it's also some other jobs like doctors and like medical doctors and medical personnel. No one wants to live in the middle of nowhere. Like my hometown has always had really shitty medical staff and lack of... Oh, escaped for today? Well then. See ya, Lila. Well, shit. We need to get some more prisoners tomorrow then. Several dozen wannabes to fill in one open teaching slot in cities. Yeah, Dalsidor. Also, they do these like a short term zone when you are there like for 6 months or something, and then they hire another guy for that, so they don't have to pay the full salary and don't have to give you like a permanent job. Which is also really bullshit. That is one extensive tunnel. Holy digging. Look at that. These four guys went and dug this massive tunnel. That is the longest tunnel I've ever seen. I didn't expect them to do this. This long tunnel. And once the slot gets taken, you can pretty much assume that it won't be open. Yeah, that's pretty much true, Dulcidor. More or less, jobs for life. They were almost out too. They actually escaped. Four prisoners escaped, Raymond. They were out. They got out. Yeah, that's a thing as well, Dulcidor. You pretty much need to be able to teach multiple things at the same time these days. Yeah, you did, Pringster. You did. But the annoying thing is that just searching through doesn't really help these days. It actually doesn't show you the tunnels in most cases. You actually need to dismantle the whole toilets to actually find the tunnel. Which I think is a dumb change. Because it just adds useless tedium to the game. Just a normal shakedown doesn't find them anymore. And you have to manually go and demolish them, replace them, all that. I don't think it's a good change. Lots of contraband. 16 waiting, 17 waiting for a 18 waiting. Yeah, that's a lot of contraband. It is Springstar. Yeah, this is a Transport Tycoon Deluxe music because the game doesn't have any on its own. It is a kind of crazy night. Especially considering that the game is supposed to be out. Yes, it does. It does. But if the game is coming out this year, and it still doesn't have any soundtrack, it's kinda surprising. Yeah, it does have a lot of music, and it's pretty awesome, like Naku says. And it's actually getting some more soon, I think. One of the main reasons for a Kickstarter for RimWorld was to actually get money to hire someone to make the music and sounds. And art. Because Tynan is not a musician or artist. I wonder if the devs completely forgot about the music. I wouldn't think so, right? They definitely need to get at least some kind of ambient background noise. I really like how RimWorld does it. Like, it's not constant music, it's kind of comes and goes. I do have some nights. We have three guys in two gangs. I don't have that many high-risk prisoners at the moment, so, or max security, so we don't have that many because of that. Actually, if they are releasing this game this year, does that mean am I getting those? Yes. Three more. Does that mean we are getting the other goodies that were promised in the Kickstarter and in the other packages? Like, there was supposed to be a physical copy of the game, some t-shirts, soundtrack, and all kinds of things. What was actually promised in that? In that package. Those Polaroids are actually still not in the game as well, which are supposed to be, and different wardens. Are there different wardens in the game? That was the highest tier to get different wardens in the game. I don't think there is more than the default warden, so that's something they need to add. Some people paid a lot of money to have them as a warden in the prison. Let's stop the shaker. And then there's the Polaroid pictures, which are supposed to be in the game as well. When you do certain things, you get this Polaroid pop-up. It's like an achievement kind of thing. Yeah, it's apparently really shitty night puzzles. And then there's the Digital Immortal Criminalize Your Face package, which I have. So you're gonna get, supposed to get the game on Steam, private forums and wiki, I got that. PDF of the art book, I don't care. Downloadable soundtrack was promised. Uplink, their older games, I have those. Name a prisoner and write his bio, I've done that. Special edition DVD. T-shirt. Frameable poster. What is this? Soundtrack CD, physical art book, prisoner sprite that looks like you. I got that. So, yeah. So I should be getting the soundtrack on a CD, T-shirt, poster, and an art book. Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Like, so they have a lot of stuff they need to send out if the game is fully releasing. Door sending income sound. Actually, there is music in this game. When you get the riot going, you have that riot music. That's the only music in the game at the moment. Yeah, nice. Nice, 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 Basisk. Twenty-seven waiting for solitary confinement. Nice. 18 prisoners up for parole. Nice. And the execution music. I've actually not done executions yet, so I don't know about those. We actually need to get the execution thingy going. The menu is free. Sounds about right. Not only is the game a microtransaction-filled broken mess, their creative director has stated on Twitter that he hates gamers. Nice. That sounds epic. That's a lot of complaints. I think my schedule is not the best. I'm gonna change 2 hours of free time in the morning. And move work and eat time 1 hour down. Might wanna give me. It might make me give up on life, Julia Lee, if I do that. Hour of reviews. Oof. That's some nice gaming right there. Oh, they're actually making the license plates now. Or just moving shit around. Did I actually put? There's one guy working here. He did a. He's just moving shit around. 3 at the moment, Beard. It destroys your life. There's some really good Crusader Kings and U4 reviews as well. Just really funny. 3,000 hours played. Not a good game. And there's someone who said like he had like 500 hours or something on the game, and he was like, yeah, it gets good after about 300 hours into the game. Sadly, yeah, Giulielli, sadly. Same here. Would be actually nice to know how many hours of a RimWorld I've played. All those hours never will be known now. People on Steam are just gonna look at me when the Steam release comes. Oh, this noob has never played the game. With like, no hours on it. Oh yeah, that's actually one of the things I was gonna say. So apparently Steam release of RimWorld has been postponed till next year. Instead of releasing now, either fully or into the early access, like he was planning earlier. And he's still gonna probably take the 6 months break from the game, I mean the developer, Tynan. Burned out on the game, so wants to make a, well, we'll take a break from the game. Oh yeah, the TV actually doesn't work right there. Because it's not phasing out the right way. Oh, I'll screw that. He has TV, it's fine. It's better grade, he has TV. Did you read the comments of Tynan? Yeah, I did. At least some of them. Probably not all of them, Sandam. The thread was also updated, after I read it. I was really disappointed in the announcement. When he was saying that he's gonna release the, either on early access or as a fully done game on Steam, and then take a 6 months break after releasing it, and then maybe coming back to RimWorld and working more on it. I was really disappointed by that because I don't think it's a ready game, and I think it needs more work. Like we discussed earlier already. Yes, he is, Sandam. It's like he doesn't know what he wants to do at the moment. He just wants... I feel like he wants out. And not have to do anything with that for a while. That's the feeling I got from it. I mean, if he's totally burned out on that, I do understand very much why he doesn't want to have anything to do with that for a while. I mean, I've been having pretty much the same with my own game. The mud I'm running. Although not so bad anymore. It was much worse earlier. But I definitely had the same thing. I didn't want to have anything to do with that. I just wanted to do other stuff like stream and other things. Well, he deserves a break. Yeah, definitely not Sandam. But he should have and could have done it differently. I mean, if he said he needs a break and that he's gonna go on a spirit journey for 6 months or something and then come back, nobody would have probably had any complaints. I would have been fine with that and have no... Well, I would have been disappointed that there's not gonna be any progress for a while, but I would have definitely understood why he wanted to do that, but that's not what he did. He wanted to release the game and then go gone for a while and maybe come back. He should have just said, I'm gonna take a break, I'll be back. See you in a few months. Although it's not like I've done my burnout on my game any better. I just basically stopped logging in into the game and just do some coding days every now and then with Dalsedur, which definitely helped to get rid of over that. I don't want to have anything to do with that. It's easy to get fed up and burned out on things if you work on those, like a single thing, for years and years. I mean, same with the Prison Architect guy, Chris. He also has a burnout on the game. And needs to take a break. Yeah, very true, Ice Hawk. Hey, Xenny. I'm doing good, I'm doing good. Both Prison Architect and Rimworld devs have been both working basically same amount, 3 years on their games, pushing out a lot of content every month or so on a schedule for 3 years. So it's easy to become very burned out on that. I don't think he's running out of ideas, Julia. I'm definitely sure he's running out of energy, though. Like he said, he had like hundreds of items on his list he wanted to add to the game. I mean, it's not that difficult to figure out a lot of nice ideas for RimWorld. I have like probably 20 instantly if I want to add some stuff on that. Depends on the people who play as well. Yeah, that's very true as well, Dalsidor. If you're getting lots of appreciative and negative comments and all kinds of bullshit all the time, it definitely makes you burn out quicker as well. Office Space style. Nice, Xenny. But there's a reason why some devs don't interact with their their fan base in any ways, because it's an easy way to get really screwed up and make you hate your life and what you're doing. I know I've had those as well, although I have the good thing that no one is paying customer for my game, so if I don't like someone, he's gone. If I really feel his toxic and influence on things. And there is a few players who I have kicked out of the game, permanent ban, just because they were a toxic influence. Also, I've been working on the game 16 plus years. So no wonder if someone wants a bit of their own time every now and then. Also, the annoying thing is that I actually like most of the players. Most of them are really great people, and it's fun to discuss things with them. But it's also that if I log in into the game, there's immediately several people telling me about things. Can you fix this? Why is this way? Can you do this? Or whatever. It's kind of difficult to even log into the game and have peace of mind. And some of them even follow me here, like Ashtamner and Dalsidor and Earth Priest there and Hyper. Cannot even get rid of them in here. No, you guys are great. All of them. What game is this? It's called it's that Fluffy. And it's a mod. Multi-user dungeon, a text-based action RPG, basically. Yeah, I'm a Night Berserk. But like Dalsidor and Ashtamnir and the other people I just said are all players from there, who I know from there. Although I've met most of you as well in real life. some of you several times. Dal Sidur, almost weekly. That company burned to the ground when you left. Ouch. Exciting. You work for a mobile company that changed management and remodeled 5 times. I managed to survive them all. Let's skip the company and latest manager that had a knack for extreme micromanagement and lying to his superior to cover his own mistakes. Ah, that's really bullshit, exciting. He used to play a hell out of mods back in college. They are still out there, Naku. You can still get addicted again. I've been only running the game a bit over 16 years, but there's people who have played the game for longer than that. Because I didn't start it myself. I just kinda inherited. Spending over 16 years on one game is a long time. And still happy to play it, even after that. These people are insane. Don't know why they are still there. Of unhappiness. I kept using my mod ideas since Alpha 7 and Alpha 9 was more of a mod pack. Yeah, I guess so, Giuliani. But I don't think Prison Architect is even close to that. I think there are still a lot of really obvious and easy things that really should be and could be added. Yeah, that's true, Dalsidur. There's a lot of reasons for that. One of the biggest ones being that people are getting old. Old and crampy and have children and better things to do than play a game. And work, yeah, well, basically we are no longer those teens with endless time to spend on things. We have work, school, family responsibilities, and other games, not just WoW, but other MMOs and other games in general. Hey Dingo, how's it going? Yeah, that is definitely something that happens. Extra unique. It definitely was, Giuliani. It definitely was. I spent so many years on that myself as well. So I can understand why there is a big exodus of players into that game or in any other game. Pretty much all the things Dingo Bear, it seems, today. You left mods for EQ1. Yeah. I think that's what a lot of people did in Naku. People left mods for MMOs in general, because it was like the next step from there. Which is definitely understandable. So hot, 31 now. Yeah, I really hate this hot weather. Yesterday was really bullshit. One of the reasons why I wasn't streaming yesterday. It was really hot in the morning, and I felt like I needed to do something other than stream and sit at the home. And I just told my wife, let's go watch a movie, let's go eat something in the city center. And just decided to go. Yes, this is Xenic. All those graphical limitations? Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Just embrace the most powerful graphical processing unit possible, your own brain, and play a text-based game. Why is this guy here? And why are you not being searched on your cell and your cell block? My wife doesn't like game? She does, she does. She's probably playing something at the moment. Are you? Fallout?
Yeah.
Yeah, so yeah. She's playing Fallout New Vegas at the moment, Xeonic, so... I guess that answers your question. Ultima Online was great, Julia. No trading, Xenic, sorry. Kinda hard to find a better one. At least one that would take me as well. Good job, Xenic. Why didn't they plant any trees here? Oh, it's wrong size. You need to do it manually. Oh, you can track this. Oh, that makes life so much easier. Got any basic tips for a newbie? Start small, Naku. Just open these reports in here and get the grants, and you get like a basic detention center and administration center grants first. You get money from those, and you get some stuff for the to-do list, like the objectives there. Yep. And this is really good guide what you need early on in the prison. And just start completing these rooms one by one. Start small. Money is really tough to come by. And once you're done with the grant, get like a next one. Whatever looks nice, like a health and well-being is good one early on, visitation rights, and whatever. Also, stop your prison intake immediately. Like, don't take any prisoners until you've got the necessary facilities. Also, don't hire any guards or cooks or anything until you're actually taking prisoners, because you're just wasting money on the salaries. sure you'll mess it up. Ah, shame you are not doing doing that on stream, because I would like love to watch that. The Green Man Gaming Patreon, and you're a Steam creator. Yeah, I'm partnered with Green Man Gaming, so you can use the link below. And if you buy something from Green Man Gaming, I get small amount of the sale. And you can also use the discount coupon to all get basically discount on anything on Green Man Gaming with that. And it's you can use multiple times as well. So whenever you're buying a game, you can get a nice discount. It's like a permanent discount on Green Man Gaming in there. And Patreon is basically a yes, online baking platform. That's it, pretty much, Julia. Patreon is basically a site where you can set up like a page with different categories, and you can subscribe on that and maybe get some benefits out of that. And you basically, it's like a, it's kind of like donating monthly. Or kind of like Twitch subscription, but not Twitch subscription. Just on a different site. So it's just a way to help me out. So Patreon versus PayPal donations, which is one is better? PayPal donation is, well, it depends how you want to support. Patreon, you can do it monthly, so you can set up like a, say, $1 each month for me. And it helps me to know that I'm gonna get that $1 or whatever it is each month, so I can plan ahead on that. So for example, if I'm gonna buy a game for a stream, I know I'm gonna get some money this day each month. PayPal donation is better because it actually gives you more money. Patreon takes about 7% of the money you're giving when they're handling that, and PayPal is basically almost all of the money you donate. But PayPal donations are kinda like random, so you never know if you're gonna get money, if someone is donating or not. Yeah, pretty much what Julia is saying. Patreon is better because it tricks you into a subscription. Yeah. But Patreon also allows you to basically set up your top limit. So if you want to donate a certain amount, it doesn't keep going till the eternity. It only goes till you've donated that certain amount in total over those months. And yeah, I am a Steam curator as well. I'm actually one of the top curators on Steam. I think I'm still a 28th out of like 34,000 or something. So I'm in the top 0.1% or something of curators on Steam. Which is really dumb. It's really, really insane if you look at the curator thing on Steam. When you look at the top curators, it's like really huge YouTube names and other guys and proper companies or websites like IGN and PC Gamer and stuff, and like Total Biscuits and Jim Sterling's and whatever else, Northern Lions, and all those are really huge big names, and then there is suddenly me. I have no idea. Says quite a lot about the whole creator system. It kind of does, Ashtamir, yes. Only reason why I'm up there is because I really, when the curator thing came out, I jumped on it immediately, and